this going out, taking away the whole, carries along everything in a no-return process, anti-regressive, anti-regression, including, maybe, including, has not the meaning of suppressing it, but including the ex-janus impermeabilities between the tones, the style, for instance, between the philosophem, the theologem, the mythem, the poem, since the Homeric-Socratic division or conflict. Everything alters, appears the parabolic. The parabolic writing would be coextensive to literature, this one, literature, being enlarged to accept the diverse discursivities, philosophical, theological, poematical, in a sort of, not a confusion, but in a sort of inter-translatability, in other terms, joining the two meanings, translatio and translation. Let us recall the ambition of the Mallarmean writing, the one of Zarathustra, the fables of Kafka, Rapport pour une Académie, Prométhée, and so on. And why not, what American poets today, some American poets today, name ethnopoetics. I call that because of the work of Jerome Rottenberg, which gather or collect the myth of Indian American ethnies, as if they were poems, that what or which they are not, they were not, since they were transcription of rites, this bit, now taken as poem and reversed in this generalized writing, as an example. O mythos demon, said Aesop. Parabolic refers to the testamental sublime through to the words of Paul de Tarse, if I may, in front of Alain, say something furtively about a quotation of Paul de Tarse, speaking of a per speculum and in enigmitate, view or viewing, hoping to see face to face, as it is written in translation, but there won't be any face to face vision. So we have to rejoice and work with the per speculum and enigmitate. So what I call here in two short way, the parabolic. In despite of his marvelous attempts, Dante has been named many times in this day, Dante shows to us nothing but the marvels of our ici-bas, down here, of our ici-bas with its au-delà, its beyond, not anyway, with its beyond. Bon, but that was my tentative of topics tonight. I thought this bon, really. Thank you.
Wonderful, you gave us a real good example, a role model for poetic thinking, and I think you spoke directly not only to the students but also to the faculty, because we are, as you know, in this program, we are always very near to that. So the Aletheia, Heidegger's Aletheia, the revelation, as you translated this, is actually a little bit more than that. It's also a concealing. It is the interplay of revealing, that is your, and concealing. So actually it does exactly what you kind of propose here, to bring back the enigma to the openness and also work on the other, what is hidden, try to give them a kind of visibility, as a work against the one-sidedness, work for the fullness of the phenomenon, which has all these elements in it. And it is actually through language how the poet allows this phenomenon to have a place, even if we in society or in our everyday life don't want it because it disturbs us or is a trouble or whatever, you know. But it has a language, it has a word, and we have to learn to listen. And the listening is a listening which has not an expectation of its own, but which can share the expectation of the phenomena, which is revealed and or concealed, I think, both at the same time in language. And I think you gave us a great example how to do that. And you encourage our students, hopefully, that they are not going to make their texts very clear and distinct. Nicht? We are not Cartesian here, not in this respect. Cartesian for the phenomenon who deserves this. But for all the others, and these are most of the others, we have to protect them. This is, as you always said, how it occurs to me, how I see it. We have to protect it from the visibility which is not really meant to be for this phenomenon. So we have here all the faculty member tonight. That's one of the nice things. Hopefully they engage in a discussion. You're already Agamben, you're already our best translator. We should give him another job now after the seminar is over. Translator, first translator in English, French. And Amital, Romanel, Elaine. I hear Zizek, who needs it most, actually, is not here tonight. He would need some poetic thinking, because he knows too much. He's a typical example for somebody who knows too much, and who believes when he says things, then everything is clear, you know? And then only he disturbs his own clearness, certainly with an accent. That is a good thing, which is paradoxical existence. Anyway, so I hope we can ask you questions. One thing I really would ask you as a favor to me, do you have a poem of your own in French here, or do you know it by heart?
I don't know in French, half of the book is in French.
Because I would love to hear one of your poets in your real language, in French. So if you, maybe at the end, we can ask him to read us before we leave.
Now or the end?
Yeah. Let's wait until the end of the discussion. It's a good, because that is something, I think, even if we don't understand, we hear the rhythm and the sound and the voice, you know, and because the English is the English, so.
Mais c'est une bonne translation pour toi.
I know. I'm sure it is, but it's not your poem. It's a poem of your translator with the material you gave the translator, nicht? And so somehow, but let's wait for it until it would be a good ending. So please let me open the discussion, the questions. As you know, we always ask the students who are not in his class, that is in this case the second year students, and I know you all, as you know, to ask him question. If you don't, I will make you. That is the rule here. You have not heard this before. Also, where are the poets among the second year classes? Hmm? Brian, for example, what do you think of?
I'm working on a question.
You're working on a question. Yeah. Don't worry, just start talking. Then the question will come following the language.